Good morning, church. It's New Year's Eve, the end of an old year, and we're getting ready to start a new year, and we want to talk about the final church, and that is the Church of Laodicea. We've already looked at the churches of Ephesus and Smyrna and Pergamos and Thyatira, the church at Sardis and also Philadelphia. Now we want to look at the seventh church, and that is the Church of Laodicea, where we had the loveless church, the loyal church, the liberal church, the licentious church, the lifeless church. This church is going to be known as the lukewarm church. And of all the churches, this seems to be the one that Jesus condemns the most. Now, let me just say a few things about it, because this is going to take us about three times, I think, in order to get through this one, because I believe it's pertinent to our age, and I'll tell you why in just a moment. I want you to notice that in chapter number 2, when he begins to talk to the churches, he talks to the first church in the church of Ephesus, and he phrases it this way: this is coming from the one who walks in the midst of the seven lampstands or candlesticks. Now, he's talking about that Jesus who walks in the midst of his churches. The churches are lights in their community. Just like the menorah in the temple had seven different branches, and each branch had oil going up to it, and it provided light inside the temple in God's house. The Gentile churches are to provide light in the communities in which we're at. And so we're the lampstands. But he's walking in the midst. But I want you to go in your scriptures to chapter number 3. And verse 14, he's talking about the Laodicean church. And at the very end of it, he talks about, I am at the door, verse 20, and I stand and I knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him and he with me. Now, oftentimes we will hear an evangelist or a pastor that will use that as an invitation, and that's all right. But really, the invitation is not just to individuals, it's to the church. The church of Laodiceans had Christ on the outside, and he could not even get in the church. It was a Christless church in many regards, and we'll look at that again a little bit more down the line. Now, there's something odd about this church that's not said about the other churches. You can take time and do this later, but I've done it for you. I want you to notice in the other six churches, he will phrase it the church of Ephesus or in Ephesus, and he'll use that word in or of, the church of Ephesus, the church of Thyatira or Pergamos or Sardis or Smyrna or the church in. But I want you to notice in chapter 14, verse 1 of, excuse me, chapter 3, verse 14. In verse 14, he says, to the angel of the church of Laodiceans write. Did you notice that? To the church of the Laodiceans. Now, maybe I'm reading a little bit too much into that. I don't think so. But he is talking about the church had become the church that belonged to the Laodiceans. In fact, the word Laodicean itself, and I believe God chose this church, Christ chose this church because of its name. Laos means laity. The Seans means kind of the rule of. And so it's the rule of the laity. That in the final church age, the church is going to become ruled not by pastors God has called out or by Christ, who truly is the head of the church and leads through his pastors or through his messengers he appoints to the churches, but the church is going to become ruled by the mob or by the laity, and thus it's going to become very lukewarm. Now, I have not pointed this out, but each one of these seven churches we've been going through not only are churches of every age, you'll find churches like each one of these. And I hope today that we in this generation, that we're the church of Philadelphia. I hope that's the flavor of our church. And so there's churches like every one of these churches. Today you'll have churches like all seven of these churches. You'll find different churches and they'll match up to one of these different churches. But also, I think Christ intended for us to understand that the entire church age, that there's going to be an overarching characteristic of the church in its generation. For instance, Ephesus probably was the church from 70 AD at the destruction of the temple to 170 AD. That was the time when the church began to lose its first love. The Smyrna church, that's the church under heavy, heavy persecution. And that would have began in 70 AD and would have continued on into 312. But again, it's the second one in line. And then as you're moving through history, going from 312 to about 606 would be the Church of Pergamos, where liberalism got into the church, where papal decrees and people began to twist the scriptures and corrupt doctrine, followed very closely by the Dark Ages. And so somewhere around 606 to about the Protestant Reformation, somewhere around that time, you had the church of Thyatira, the corrupt church. And then there began to be a Reformation. But during that time, it was known as the Dead Church. And so from 1517 to about 1750, so we're getting close to our time, would be in the time of the church of Sardis, the Dead Church. But then something miraculous happened about 1750. And it goes all the way up until about the 1900s. So for about 150 years, there was a great outpouring of God's Holy Spirit. There was the Church of the Open Door, the Philadelphia Church. And the church age became known for missions and evangelism. And the scriptures were being passed out in various languages around the world. And there were great awakenings and these massive revivals on all continents seemed to be taking place, and the gospel was getting into places it had never gotten into. And so there was this Church of the Open Door. But about 1900 till present, what began to happen is lukewarmism. And that is, we are in the Church of Laodicea. Now, just let me read an article for you. This comes from J.A. Sice, and then we'll look at some other things down the line. He also designates, and he lived 100 years or so ago. Actually, this one I'm going to be reading was actually published 120 years ago. But this is what he says, and I quote concerning the Church of Laodicea. Its name designates it as a church of mob rule, the democratic church, in which everything is swayed and decided by popular opinion, clamor, or voting, and hence a self-righteous and self-sufficient church. It is described as thinking it is the perfection of churches. It said in its heart, I am rich, increased with goods, have need of nothing. But never was a body of people so woefully self-deluded. With all this boastfulness, the faithful and true witness found nothing with which he could abide and pronounces them wretched and pitiable and poor and blind and naked and about to be vomited up and cast out. End quote. And I think that describes, again, this church age. Let's not let that be about Emmanuel. And it happens on individual levels. As long as we are fervent in spirit, we're on fire with the Lord individually, then our church will be also. Let us pray together. Father, as we end this new year, we acknowledge that we haven't been all that we needed to be as a church or individually. And we ask your forgiveness as we move into a brand new year. We pray that we rededicate ourselves unto you, that we might be fervent in spirit, ready to do the ministry that you've called us to do with a right and a glad spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.